In this video, we have a projectile motion problem, and it's an elevated launch position. So this cannonball is shot from 72 meters above sea level, and then it lands all the way down at sea level. Well, that breaks the symmetry of the problem. So there's a very common formula in the textbooks that gives you the range of a projectile based on the launch angle and the speed, but that formula only applies to a level surface. So that no longer applies. We have to take a more general approach to everything. And in this video, I've asked basically everything that I could ask about the projectile. So in part A, I want the flight time. In part B, I want the range. In part C, I want the maximum height above the sea. And in part D, I want the impact speed when the projectile hits the water. So the prep work that we normally do before anything else is to break that launch velocity into its components. And the x component is going to be 150 cosine of 38. And that gives me about 118.2 meters per second. So the projectile is moving that fast to the right. Simultaneously, it's moving up. And that component is given by 150 sine of 38. And that's about 92.3 meters per second. One last thing I'll do as prep work is just to very clearly label what my origin is. And I want to call the initial x position 0. And then I'm going to make sea level the origin of coordinates for the y coordinate. And in part A, I'm asked for the flight time of the cannonball. And because I know the final y position when this thing lands, I have a little bit of extra information about the vertical analysis of the flight. And that's how I know to start this question A, by looking at the vertical analysis. So the y motion of the cannonball follows the standard kinematics equation, y equals y naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 ay times t squared, because the acceleration in the y direction is constant. And remember, that acceleration is the acceleration induced by gravity, so that'll be negative 9.8 meters per second squared. My final y position for the flight is 0. My initial is 72 meters off the surface of the ocean. My initial y velocity was about 92.3 meters per second. And again, I'm going to sub in ay equals negative 9.8. Half of that is 4.9, so I get negative 4.9 t squared. So we're left with a quadratic equation to solve, and I prefer to have a positive coefficient on the quadratic term, so I'm going to move all of the terms to the left-hand side. And I've gotten to the point where I don't ask students to show me all the steps in the quadratic formula anymore, because so many students have an algorithm built into their calculator anyway. But if you want to show everything by hand, you would use the quadratic formula at this point. And that starts with a negative b, so that's the coefficient of t, negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c. And there's a double negative in that second term because c is negative. And then all divided by 2 times a, and 2 times 4.9 is 9.8. So when you run the numbers on that square root piece, that simplifies to 99.65. And I can immediately tell I'm going to get a positive solution and a negative solution. And it's definitely the positive one that I want to keep because our time starts at t equals 0. It's interesting to wonder why there's a negative solution in there. And what that's about is just that the mathematical model we've built doesn't include the physics of the launch itself. It's just a model of an object in free fall moving in two dimensions. So our extraneous solution corresponds to the moment where the projectile was flying up from sea level before it reached the tip of the cannon at t equals 0. Well, we know that wasn't really happening physically, so we discard that solution. I'm going to keep only the plus in here because it gives me a positive solution. And that positive solution is 19.6. seconds. Now in practice, I don't see anything wrong with just relying on technology for using the quadratic formula with a bunch of decimals. So here we are in wxMaxima, that's a free computer algebra system, and I put in solve this equation, so I just wrote down the equation for the variable t, and then I put the word float out in front, which means give me a decimal approximation, and I hit shift enter. And I can see my two solutions. I have a negative 0.75 seconds or a positive 19.6 seconds. That, of course, is the one that we're going to keep. The syntax would be very similar if you wanted to use Wolfram Alpha, for example. In part B, we're asked for the range of the cannonball. In other words, what's the horizontal position relative to the launch position when this thing lands? And we normally use an R for that, so I'll just pop that into the diagram. So we look at the horizontal analysis of the flight, and I have x equals x naught plus v naught xt, just the standard equation of motion for constant acceleration kinematics, plus 1/2 ax t squared. And then a key feature of projectile motion is the acceleration in the horizontal direction is zero. In other words, the x velocity is constant. So that acceleration term is gone. And then we put the origin at the initial position of the object. So the initial x value is zero. And I basically just get distance equals rate times time out of this. So my final x position, I'll call that capital R, is going to be my x velocity times the flight time. And when I crunch the numbers, I get 2,320 meters, just keeping three sig figs. Next, I want to find the maximum height above the sea for this projectile. And just a word of caution here, you may be used to using half the flight time in order to determine the maximum height, but that only applies to a level surface. So if I was launching something from the same level that it lands on, then it reaches its highest point at half the flight time. But again, our symmetry is broken, so we have to take a more fundamental approach. And the key physical fact for finding the maximum height is that it's the transition between the object moving up and the object moving down. At the transition between positive and negative velocity, the velocity is momentarily zero. So Vy is equal to zero at the maximum height. Now, the easiest way to get at the maximum height is to use our third kinematics formula. So provided we have constant acceleration in the y direction, this formula is valid. And then I plug in the fact that the y velocity is zero at the maximum height. And then my initial y velocity, that was 92.3. A in the y direction is negative 9.8, so I move the minus sign out in front there. The y value at this moment of interest, that's what we're after, so that's y. And then my initial y value was 72. So when I crunch the numbers on this to solve for y, I get a maximum height of 507 meters. Note that it's perfectly fine if you want to plug in Vy equals zero into the kinematics equation, V equals V naught plus AT, and then you could solve for the time of the maximum height and then plug it in to this equation of motion for the y coordinate, and you'll find the same value of 507 meters. In part D, we're asked for the impact speed when the ball hits the water. And this has to be done by components. There is a sneaky way to do this using the concept of gravitational potential energy, but we don't have that yet at this point in the course. So I'm going to get into the details of the velocity components when the cannonball strikes the surface of the water. Just to visualize that real quick, there's the impact velocity vector. And that's made of a horizontal component, that's Vx final, and a vertical component, Vy final. Vx final is the easy one because the x velocity never changes. So I know immediately that that's 118.2 meters per second. Vy final requires a bit of calculation. Again, Vy is V naught y plus Ay times T. And my initial Y velocity was 92.3 meters per second. My acceleration, -9.8. My flight time, 19.6. And I get a final Y velocity of -99.8 meters per second. The minus sign is there because my final Y velocity is downward. Then I have to vector add these two components. My X component is 118.2. My y component, I'm just going to write the magnitude of it on there, 99.8. And the magnitude of my final velocity vector, I'm just going to call v. Now, it's just the length of that that's equal to the speed when this thing hits the water. I wasn't asked for the angle. So we just use the Pythagorean theorem on this right triangle. And when I run the numbers, I get an impact speed of 155 meters per second. Note that in some problems, you'll be asked for the angle at which the projectile strikes the ground. And in that case, you could just quickly use an inverse tangent to find the size of that angle that I labeled. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.